Welcome to this AbundantChange.com program, brought to you by Music Outreach Publishing. We here at Music Outreach hope you will enjoy and be uplifted by this offering, and wish you many blessings. And now, without further ado, here is author and founder of Music Outreach Publishing, Michael Purvis. Hello, everyone. I'm Michael Purvis, the author of this program and founder of AbundantChange.com and Music Outreach Publishing. The AbundantChange.com recording you're about to experience is my attempt to delight, uplift, and instruct people of all ages through music and the spoken and written word throughout the United States and all over the world. As an author, inspirational performer, artist, and teacher, I have made it my goal to create inspiring books, recordings, and videos which will touch the lives of and benefit children, youths, young adults, adults, couples, and senior citizens. So, through the magic of technology, here I am, ready to uplift you with words and music on all sorts of beneficial, uplifting, spiritual, and growth-inducing topics. If you or someone you know would like more information about AbundantChange.com materials available worldwide from Music Outreach Publishing, stay with us at the end of this recording, and we'll give you information about how to contact us. And now, on with our program. We'll begin with our Abundant Change theme song. Speak to all ages, God's gift to me and you. You can put them down to music, or read and write them too. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life anew. May this book be my special gift to you. Old or young, tall or short, we all have tales to tell. We've dreams to dream and things to learn, so we can grow so well. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life anew. May this book be my special gift to you. Growing, changing, that's the life we lead. In our hearts and minds and spirits, we have all we need. So now, as we begin our tale, may I be so bold as to hope that it will lift you up, help your new worlds to unfold. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life anew. May this book be my special gift to you. Blessings to you from Abundant Change. The Sojourners, a story for young adults and adults on change, growth, coming of age, and coming into our own. Copyright Michael D. Purvis. Introduction. Oh, how life changes. How we are constantly surprised by the shifts, endings, and new beginnings fate brings our way. But if we change, grow, and roll with the changes of life, what a journey it can be. We can evolve, and life will never be boring if we remain green and growing inside. Yes, there will be difficulties and sorrows and goodbyes, but hellos and new beginnings come after these. We truly are sojourners, travelers. This is what life is all about. This all sounds a bit like a platitude, yet how true it is. Witness this in our story, The Sojourners, and see how two boys experience this for themselves, as the world they treasure is turned upside down, and they are given the gift of the journey of a lifetime. The journey which is their lifetime, their own sojourn. Thrill to your own memories of setting out to start your life if you are older, or imagine what it will be like if you are younger. Either way, please enjoy The Sojourners. The author. Chapter 1. James and John lived a wonderful life as boys, and much of this was due to their delightful parents. Their parents were, you see, rather unusual sorts. The mother of the family was a writer and an artist. This made her an especially sensitive and unique mother who had keen powers of observation and who promoted this in her children. The boy's father was a kind of Renaissance man, a man for all seasons, many said. He had been a cowboy in his youth and a rodeo rider. After his Wild West days, he had for a large part of his life been a journalist who traveled all over the world. Finally, though, he settled with his beautiful artist-writer wife on a farm where this kindly and accomplished duo proceeded to make a rather idyllic life, publishing books and a newspaper together, amongst other activities. They loved their life on the farm, this unusual couple. They loved it all, riding horses, writing and publishing, growing their own organic food, and even running a small greenhouse which contained rare and hard-to-find plants. They were such an interesting couple and had many friends. Many people came to visit with the young folks and to hear their stories of the full life they had led. They came to feed the horses lumps of sugar, to have delicious organic dinners, to see the fascinating plants in the greenhouse, and to admire the lovely paintings of the mother. They left with armloads of wonderful bread that the man and his wife had baked, which could be smelled for miles around when it was bread-baking time. They left, too, weighted down with armloads of wonderful herbs and plants, which they took home and planted in their gardens. It was thus that this couple nourished the small community in a beautiful way, and though they tended to be a little outspoken in their views on life and the world, they were greatly loved by all. So it was that when the mother had two boys in short succession, it was a matter of great interest for their small town. They were a special family, indeed. Chapter 2. The two little boys, which the mother and father named John and James, were a joy not only to the townspeople, but to the mother and father as well. They took to the varied and unusual life on this artistic farm as a fish would to water. In fact, seemingly to prove this point, they loved, just as fish would, swimming in the farm's pond. They loved, too, riding the horses, rolling and playing in its golden meadows, and picking fragrant bunches of the herbs and flowers which grew in abundance all over the property. They would bring armloads of these herbs and flowers to their mother, who would weave them into garlands and make of them wreaths which were given and sold to the many visitors of the farm. She would cook with them, too, and together with her husband would make unusual, fine-smelling breads, which were mouth-watering. It was indeed an idyllic life. And what else did this life contain? Well, there was also in abundance on this farm books. Cases and cases of them lined the wall of the old farmhouse. There was, too, music. Sitting about the music room, which was next to the library in the farmhouse, were guitars, a piano, flutes, a violin, and all sorts of other instruments, which their father, a musician as well as cowboy and journalist, knew how to play. The boys learned to play them all, too. They also learned to draw and paint with the help of their mother. And in the evenings, the family would read together, talk spiritedly, and laugh heartily. They read the little paper they published, along with papers from around the world, and discussed current events. They read stories and poetry, and played their musical instruments. They sang, too, and even danced. Often there were visitors who loved to share in all this. The room would be filled with people of all ages, sizes, shapes, and colors. And when this diverse company came, there was food from the farm in abundance also, in many shapes, sizes, and colors. These were beautiful tomatoes, cheeses, salads, vegetables, nuts, and fruits. It was like one of the mother's paintings, filled with much to see, a feast for the eyes, and the heart, and the stomach. There wasn't much time for television in this life, for they were all much too interested in each other, and in this world of love, friendship, ideas, stories, art, poetry, and music which they shared. Some might think this all very strange, but to them it was quite normal and wonderful. The paper was rather a joint project. Even the boys became involved. As they grew older and had honed their writing skill, they wrote articles for this little paper that their father published on the farm. It was indeed a small little paper and a tiny operation, yet it was amazing how the publication made its way out into this world quite effectively. In addition to a small but faithful subscription base, it was tucked under the elbows of the farm's visitors, along with armloads of bread and herbs. The four lived a sunny, creative life, which might have been rather insular were it not for the fact that they shared it with so many. For there were many friends, families, and visitors who shared in and touched the life of this farm. These included those who came to the farm physically for vegetables, bread, greenhouse plants, paintings, and gatherings, and those who visited vicariously through the paper. Chapter 3. Were there problems? Certainly there were. Sometimes money was short, for bread, flowers, plants, paintings, and small community newspapers do not always pay the bills so well. And was there any regret? No, not really. Not for any of them. Their lives were so full of beauty, there wasn't room for much worry or negativity. But could such an existence go on forever? One might wonder. Sometimes it seemed as though it just might go on forever. During the summer, there were days of golden grasses blowing in the meadow and fragrant fields. There were clear, starry fall evenings filled with the smell of autumn. There were, too, crisp winter days and blankets of snow, creating a warm, cozy atmosphere in the old farmhouse, which was filled with the smell of bread baking as all huddled inside during winter's blanket of cold. And of course there were glorious springs, with all the flowers beginning to grow and bloom, and everything in the landscape coming alive. It seemed as if there was life in every season. Together they assumed it would go on forever, though being readers, thinkers, and observers of life, and mental travelers to many lands through books, they knew there were many possible outcomes for stories which were filled with beauty. They had read the tragedies of ancient Greece and knew that in the space of a day, all could unravel. Yet, did they think this could happen to them? In truth, they did not think of it, but simply flowed along, which in truth is probably the best strategy for human existence. And so, when it came time for the mother and father to celebrate their 30th wedding anniversary, to go off to some faraway land to visit places they had known when they were young, to see the cities of Europe and the plains of Africa, the boys were excited. Though they were not going along, they knew it was a special trip which would give their parents time to celebrate their love. The two boys were in reality not boys at all anymore. They were young men now, for they were considering what colleges they might attend. These two men thought not of the danger involved in such travel, but of excitement. They thought of the stories their parents would tell upon their return. They wondered what paintings their mother would be inspired to paint of faraway places, what delicious recipes for bread she would discover, and what rare plants she would study in the meadows of France or the plains of Central Africa. They looked forward to reading the wonderful articles their father would write about the journey, viewing the photos he would take, and watching the documentary films he would likely make about what he experienced. They thought only of these things, and they were happy. Chapter 4. The boys watched the big plane take off in the airport. Their spirited grandmother stood next to them. She was a reassuring presence, as always, with her handsome white hair, peasant skirt, and youthful backpack upon her shoulders. The three waved, sighed, and smiled, thinking how wonderful it would be when next they greeted their parents, who upon their return would be world travelers once again. After waving, smiling, and watching the two beloved departing travelers disappear into the walkway attached to the plane, the three, grandmother and two grandsons, walked through the airport. As they traversed its cavernous interior, they hardly noticed all around them. They were not much aware of the muzak, the weary travelers, the guards or kiosks. No, they did not pay much attention to all these accoutrements of an airport in a major city. For they were still basking in the glow of sending the two soon-to-be world travelers off on the trip of a lifetime. They were thinking about this fabulous trip, and simply feeling in their hearts how much they loved these two, who were both children to the grandmother and parents to the boys. The three smiled as they walked, and soon, before they knew it, they were climbing into the grandmother's 1968 forest-green, ground-hugging Sunbeam automobile. As the boys knew well, it was quite an experience to ride in this unusual, old, sporty car with their grandmother gripping the wheel and wearing the wide-brimmed straw hat she always wore when driving it. They knew as well what a ride with their grandma in her Sunbeam was a bit like entering in the Grand Prix. Needless to say, the two boys took every opportunity they could to ride with their rather un-grandmother-like grandmother, though usually their mother quietly and tactfully discouraged it. And so, when they were all safely buckled in, with the grandmother looking a bit like a Southern Belle, but driving quite a lot like Mr. Toad of Toad Hall, and had pulled out of the parking garage with a squeal, the boys knew they were in for a treat. As the plane was cruising above their city, the three landlocked ones zoomed around the interstate and were off to another treat, something as superb as the room zoom of the Sunbeam, but decidedly more culinary. Grandmother steered the green sports car off an unfamiliar exit ramp, prompting one of the boys to ask, hoping to appear casual in tone, "Where are we going, Grams?" "Oh," she replied with an air of nonchalance, which the two young men knew from experience meant trouble, "I have a little, shall we say, surprise for you boys." Both of them thought, "Uh-oh," in their minds, but did not say this. Instead, they asked almost in unison, trying to sound unconcerned, "A surprise?" She answered their question with a question, a habit of hers. They, as well as both their parents, had by now grown quite used to. "Ever eaten a snail?" she queried. The boys looked at each other, grimaced, gulped just a bit, and then, quickly checking the rearview mirror to see if their grandma had noticed their less-than-gallant reaction, said pleasantly, smiling weakly, "Nope, Grams, and can't say as we ever have," respectively. They knew there was no getting out of it. Snails it was. When their grandma had a surprise planned, they may as well, as they knew from experience, count on experiencing whatever it was. And there definitely wasn't much they could do about this one, for they were literally along for the ride. They just hoped there was plenty of ketchup on the table. When they got to the quaint roadside French restaurant to which their grandmother took them to as their surprise, the boys did indeed have escargot, which they learned was the term for snails. They actually weren't half bad, tasting a bit like rubber tires cooked in garlic. They had also a delicious stew with cream sauce, wonderful salad, and all sorts of things. So it was that while their parents were off on the first leg of their journey, eating peanuts and soda way up in the stratosphere, the boys were munching on rather expensive garlic rubber tires with their grandma. What a day it was. When they were home and tucked in their beds, listening to the tinkle of their grandmother playing Chopin on the piano in the music room and drifting off to sleep, they both had a special smile on their lips, thinking how lucky and blessed they were to live in such a big and wondrous, yet curiously snug and cozy world. It was both. They had known this all along. The life at the farm had proved this to them many times, with its visitors, books, art, animals, plants, and music. Yet this day had really brought this home to them. The two young fellows lay in bed and ruminated upon how fascinating it was that so many worlds could exist at once, the airport with its strange glare, weary travelers, guards, and flying chariots, the roaring interstate with its myriad racing cars, the French restaurant with its escargot, the huge world their parents were on their way to visit, and the little farm they called home, which was so cozy, but contained so much. When the two had been little boys, the farm had seemed the hugest, most varied place in the world, and indeed it was a wondrous place still. Now, however, on the eve of their parents' departure on a world trip, they had some inkling how truly large was the world, and what a multitude of experience was available to them as they made their earthly sojourn. The two boys pulled up the covers, smiled sleepily, and thought on all of this to the strains of Chopin as they drifted off to sleep. Chapter 5. The morning came. It was summertime, and there was no school. The boys awoke to delightful smells and knew it was their grandmother cooking for them. They were used to wondrous smells, what with all the flowers and herbs and bread and delicious things their mother cooked. Yet there was something comforting about their grandmother's cooking. This grandmotherly cooking was not quite as fancy as their mother's, and it was not as surprising as their father's, which sometimes bordered on the fantastic and other times was a bit of a challenge to palate. Their father, you see, loved to experiment with all of the herbs and flowers found on the farm, sometimes a bit recklessly, as the boys knew from experience. No, their grandmother's cooking did not involve risks in partaking of it. And she would eat cream sauce and snails at a French restaurant, but did not make these herself. They were confident that while her cooking might not contain capricious mixtures of herbs, olive oil, and garlic, as their father's might, it would be delicious and wholesome. They were sure to love it. Besides, even their father couldn't mess up eggs, bacon, and toast. Well, on second thought, as they discussed this, they agreed that perhaps he could. Oh, well, not to worry. They both thought in their minds, Grams is here. Down the stairs of the old farmhouse, they bounced and into the chairs of the kitchen table. They had come at the beck and call of their grandmother, who was enjoying her role as farm woman, calling the boys to breakfast. She did it with a loud, Boys, time for breakfast! Just as she imagined a farm woman might, though in reality she was a city lady. And just as their own reassuring thoughts of their confidence in their gram had predicted, the boys enjoyed the wonderful breakfast their grandmother had prepared. They ate so much that they were feeling a bit sleepy, as though they needed a nap, despite the fact that they had just awakened. Perhaps it had just been too much excitement yesterday, and they were a bit tuckered out. And so, when there was the ring of the telephone, it startled them, enervated them a bit, woke them up, as an alarm might. Their grandmother moved to the end of the kitchen and pulled the old phone with its tangled cord off its receiver. "Hello," she said with a melodious voice, and then there was a pause. The boys were busy teasing and jabbing each other, as boys are wont to do, so at first they did not even notice the stricken look which came across the face of their grandmother. Just as they were about to launch into a full-scale episode of youthful, playful abandon, John, the younger of the two brothers, who tended to be more sensitive and noticeful of such things, saw the sunken look which came across his grandmother's face. He saw her body begin to crumple, and jumped up to catch her as she let the receiver drop to the floor. The boys and their grandmother could never have imagined such a phone call would bring such a huge change to their lives. Literally, in one swoop, the boys lost their mother and father, and the grandmother lost a daughter and a beloved son-in-law. The plane, beset with engine troubles and battling turbulence and bad weather, had lost altitude, lost its fuel, and ultimately crashed into the ocean after making a beeline for the surface of the water. It pained the three of them to think of the beloved mother and father, so filled with life and love, with so much life ahead of them, crashing into the ocean in such a way. It came as a terrible shock, of course. It seemed unreal. There was a beautiful funeral. There were many friends and neighbors who brought food and gave offers of help. Grandmother moved from the city to stay with the boys at the farm. She did what she could to keep the greenhouse going, and even baked bread according to some of her daughter's recipes. But it was not the same. And yet, when the boys looked about at the mother's paintings and all of the books their parents had collected over the years lining the walls, it seemed as if their parents were just away and would return. The boys put off their plans for college, for they just did not have the heart to attend. They seemed to be a bit lost, a bit without a rudder or compass. Grandmother tried to guide, but they needed some time to process it all. And so a year passed in what seemed the blink of an eye. It was summertime and nearing the anniversary of the fateful trip which the boys' parents had taken. The two young men knew that this date was coming. They knew, too, that they must decide what they were to do with their lives, for they were very young and indeed had their whole lives ahead of them. One cannot wait forever, they knew. Sometimes one must just take a step and see where it leads, they felt intuitively. And so, with this knowledge in mind, the two boys talked late one night. Grandmother played Chopin below as she did nearly every evening, though they never felt quite as safe and secure as they had that night when they returned from seeing their parents off on their grand 30th anniversary tour. Still, they felt as safe as one could feel under the circumstances, and Grandmother and Chopin did help a little. On the night before this anniversary, they lay awake. They could not sleep, so they talked of what they should do, and that is, when James, the older of the two, who, though he was not quite as sensitive and noticeable of feelings as his younger brother, got an idea. "Well, John," he said, "Mother and father went on a trip, and they are on a journey now. We can't see them, but we know they are in what Grandma would call heaven, probably having the time of their lives." John looked thoughtful and considered the scenario his brother had painted with words. "Dad probably has a newspaper, don't you think?" James asked. John smiled, even laughed just a bit, and agreed. And then, rather spontaneously, the young man added a suggestion and a question all at once. "How about if we take a trip?" "A trip?" asked John. Are you a parrot or what? Yeah, a trip, James replied in brotherly fashion. John considered. Well, under the circumstances, he said, it might be the most appropriate thing to do. We don't know for sure what we want to make of our lives. James interjected, interrupting, and finishing his sibling's thought, said, and Mom and Dad never got to complete that trip. Maybe we can finish it for them. And so it was that the two boys knew what they must do. Chapter 8. Grandmother waved with tears in her eyes as the two boys stood beside the rather rusted old hatchback, which had been their parents' trusty automobile. It was packed with all the things they would need for a journey which reflected who these two boys were. They had come from unconventional, rather intellectual and artsy parents, creative parents who had made for them an unusual life, an unusual world which served as the little cocoon for these two boys to burst forth from. And so, this car was indeed packed with everything they would need for the journey. The old auto was a little microcosm, mirroring the macrocosm of the farm. It held two guitars and two saddles for riding horses, though where they would find the horses they did not know. It held a camera, canvases, drawing paper, brushes, paints and pencils, a typewriter, and even their father's movie camera, which miraculously had washed up on the shore and had been returned to them after the terrible plane wreck. Yes, the two boys were going to make a journey, yet they didn't know exactly to where they would travel. They knew that, to be truthful, danger did lurk and could rear its ugly head unexpectedly. They had learned this the hard way because of their parents' accident. Yet, in their hearts, they knew that being afraid of danger was not the way to live life. It was, they felt, a big, beautiful, possibility-filled world. This is the way they saw it. Grandmother had a few extra tears in her eyes, knowing that these two boys had been given such a wonderful background and were taking a special journey, armed with hope, joy, and that endurance and naivete which is the hallmark of the young. Oh, what an adventure it will be, she thought. But she also, just to be sure of her boy's safety, grasped the holy medal around her neck, which her own grandmother had given her years ago. She kissed it, and though she wasn't sure she believed in St. Christopher, said to the old saint with all her heart, "Watch out for my boys." Chapter 9. And just what happened on this wonderful journey that the two boys took? Oh, many, many things. Things that would take hours and pages and countless bottles of ink to relate. Did they enjoy it? Oh, yes. When they were quite elderly and James was a famous photographer and journalist, rather like his father, and John was a famous artist, very sensitive and observational of the world, rather like his mother, they would sit in their studios and relate to their students, their prodigies, all the wondrous happenings of this journey. They would tell to the young, eager faces with listening, watchful eyes all they had encountered, all the experiences that they had eagerly consumed, as if it were food, as if it were nourishment, for indeed it was. They had learned about people and places and experiences and how all of these shape and influence each other. They met all sorts of folks and found themselves in all sorts of situations as they traveled all across the country in their little beaten-up car filled with all sorts of tools for a creative journey. They discovered that where we come from, who our families and people are, shape us to a great extent, and yet they met individuals along the way who were doing unusual and interesting things which diverged from their upbringing. In some ways, we embrace where we come from, and in other ways, we step out, they each told their students in their own way. each in their own way related to those who gathered about them, that humans must take giant steps, even though we are unsure. Both of the boys, now men, had met people who were afraid of life, whose dreams never came to fruition. And, too, they met ones who embraced life, huge risk-takers and big thinkers, and all sorts of folks on various degrees of the spectrum in between these two extremes. They, in their journeys, had seen wonderful landscapes filled with the majesty of God's creation and tiny, delightful little towns filled with tradition, kindliness, and loveliness. Sunny green towns with church towers that played chimes on courthouse squares. They had stared in wonder at huge cities with skyscrapers reaching up into the atmosphere and shining in the sun. They had read Walt Whitman and Hart Crane. They took pictures, made films, painted canvases, rode horses, and made their daily bread however they could. Whatever they did, whatever they experienced, they learned. They learned so much. And when finally they found themselves, found those things which brought them joy, and in turn brought joy to others, they made a life for themselves out of these. They gathered knowledge and expertise always, and continually increased their own joy and their contribution to the world. They knew that the journey they set out upon as young men, and all which had preceded it, parents, grandmother, the farm, and all that they had learned as children, the gift of their bodies, minds, and spirits, had all come together to make this beautiful creation. And just what was this creation? It was, they knew full well, now that they were old men, themselves. And what a joy this was for both themselves and for others, since, as they knew, they and the world were all connected. The icing on the cake was faith and hope, and quite simply, a willingness to keep going, to keep trying new things. This simple message they would tell their students constantly and in many different ways. This simple wisdom spread from mouth to mouth, and many students, friends, and loved ones came, for many were drawn to the brothers. Oh, they had a happy life. And what did they feel in their hearts? Thankfulness. They felt nothing but thankfulness for all of it, even for the suffering, for in the processing of suffering, in tears, is the genesis of healing, rebirth, and new beginnings. Yes, this they knew too. What did they say when they were asked, "Who are you?" They would say, "We are sojourners. We are travelers. We are making a pilgrimage to joy, to creativity, and to the ever-unfolding becoming of who we are." And that, they would tell their students, and anyone who asked, is your task too. Now go on your journey. Every single day of their lives, they would say to whoever asked the secret of happiness and creativity, make wonderful films, take wonderful pictures, paint canvases and write books, do whatever you love. It is your gift to the world. Tell others of your journey, for it is in sharing that we enrich, enhance, and nurture each other. This was the message of the Sojourners. And what a sojourn it was, and is yet today. For, because they shared all that they were, and all that they had learned, and because all is connected, they live on eternally. The AbundantChange.com program you have been listening to was made right here in the Music Outreach Publishing Studio in an effort to reach people of all ages across the United States and throughout the world with delightful, uplifting, instructive materials. In addition to this recording, Music Outreach Publishing offers many other AbundantChange.com books, CDs, cassettes, and videos, which appeal to a wide audience, including children, youths, young adults, adults, couples, and senior citizens. If you would like a recording of this program, or to order any other AbundantChange.com materials, you may contact us any of the following ways. You may call our order line at 317-577-8842, extension 2. You may fax us your questions, comments, or orders at 317-585-0748. You may contact us by email at musicbymichael@aol.com. And you may order online at www.abundantchange.com. You may also want to visit our sister websites, music-outreach.com, for uplifting books, recordings, and videos for the elderly, or playsingandream.com for home study courses in piano, voice, guitar, and life enhancement. You may contact the author, Michael Purvis, via the contact page on any of our websites. And now, nothing remains but to wish you peace and many blessings.